Thank you. Give it up for Matt. Give it up for the Kennedy Center, all you guys. Working very hard. I am so happy to be here. I want to thank you guys for coming out to see Patton Oswalt. A round of applause for Patton Oswalt. As well as for sitting through me before you see Patton Oswalt. I appreciate you guys for that as well. He's from right here, from the great state of Virginia. We got Virginia. It's Virginia in the house, yeah. Virginia. It's a big year for Virginia. You guys won the national championship in basketball. And also blackface. Congratulations, you guys, for that. Right out in the forefront of that. Yeah. Most times, we got to wait till Halloween for blackface stories. They were like, nah, Black History Month, we got it. You got Justin Trudeau involved now? You going across color? We're going to have to ask for 10 years yearbook receipts now to run for office. I'm pretty sure. You done blackface? Blackface? No? All the kids are doing it, evidently. I had to ask. I don't think there's anything wrong with it. You know, personally, I think anybody who wants to have the black experience should be able to have the black experience. You just have to keep it for a minimum of 1 year. Get the full experience. That's all I ask. You wearing blackface to the party don't impress me. You keep that same energy when the cops come. Talking about, they can't arrest me for no reason. We've been telling you about that. For the last 150 years. I'm from Maryland myself. It's Maryland. Yeah. We have our own issues in Maryland. You know what the motto of Maryland is, the state motto? Maryland is known as the free state. Still, in the year 2019, Maryland is known as the free state. I'm always curious, like, if I walk over the state line into Virginia, some old slave would jump out the bushes, like, I wouldn't do that if I was you. Harriet said, stay close to the river. You know what Virginia's state motto is? Virginia is for lovers, yes, of slavery. It says that on the back of the sign. Yeah, a lot of people don't read the fine print on that one. Yeah. You consider yourselves woke? You guys a woke audience? You guys woke? Everybody brag, oh, I'm woke on Twitter. Oh, I'm woke as fuck. I'm not what you would call woke as fuck. I'm what you would call woke as necessary. I was on the forefront of lambasting Chick-fil-A for their treatment of the LGBT community ever since Popeye's chicken sandwich came out. It's really what opened my eyes to the whole thing. Sometimes woke goes too far. Like, we made Spider-Man woke. Do you see that? Into the Spider-Verse, they made the black Spanish Spider-Man, and next thing you know, he's kicked out of the Marvel Universe for graffiti. See that? Superheroes are important. I think superheroes are important because growing up in this area is certainly not going to be the athletes. It wasn't going to be the Redskins. I blame the Redskins for all my failure in life. I didn't know you could win. As a kid, I just aspired to get to 500 and raise ticket prices. That's really as far as it went. Are you a Redskins fan? No? Congratulations. Good for you. I actually do think, I'm at the point of thinking they actually might be cursed until they change the name. I didn't want to admit that, but too many years have gone by now. At least get a better excuse. You realize the Redskins' argument in court for why they should keep that name was the team was established before the law that banned offensive nicknames. So basically, their racism is grandfathered in. That's like me applying for a job. Well, the bad news is you didn't get the job. But the good news is we never hire black people. We've been racist for years. We'll give the Redskins credit for one thing, though. At least they're historically accurate. Because they lose to the Cowboys every year. it's not even a game at this point. It's more like a reenactment we have to sit through twice a year. But we always beat Buffalo, so that's good. Yeah. Bears give us some trouble. You know how it is. One thing I am proud of this area, though, we snapped the sellout streak, which I appreciate, because why should you feel subjected and, like, forced to go to the games if you don't enjoy what's going on? I love that, you know? We used to show up, come hell or high water, it didn't matter. I didn't understand that, you know? When you break up with a girl, you leave. You don't stick around and boo her around the house. You don't shower her with beer on her way to work. Talking about overrated. You like that deal that Jay-Z did with the NFL? Well, Jay-Z did a deal with the NFL. Jay-Z partnered with the NFL. Well, let me tell you. So I feel a kinship with Jay-Z because growing up, kids said I look like Jay-Z, which is bullying. They didn't say I was rich as Jay-Z. They didn't say I was talented as Jay-Z. No, they said I look like Jay-Z. Y'all see what he looks like. Now they say I look like Jay-Z if he never made money. Like if he picked the wrong member of Destiny's Child. Had to get a second job to support her dream. I'm Jay-Z with Michelle. That's who I am, basically, right now. Oh, we got Michelle fans in the audience. I mean, somebody let her know. I don't know. You guys online, you doing online dating? You guys doing that? You doing online? What's the site? What's the good site now? Use Bumble. Wait, Bumble is the one where she has to contact you first. Oh, okay. I like that if I had any faith that anybody would contact me first. Really, the most attractive thing you could do is not want me, which makes me not a good candidate for Bumble, specifically. The only weird thing about, like, the online dating and even social media is my dating depends on my ability to embarrass myself and disappear. I got to be able to disappear. I can't let you find me, you know? Then things go awry, and all of a sudden I got to hear about my foot fetish from my buddies for the next 7 months. Calling me like, yeah, man, come on, watch the football game. I know you love football. I don't need that. But you're a good-looking dude, man. I feel like you should be able to just... I never had that approach random women on the street game. Some guys had that game. I just never had that game. You know, matter of fact, when I see a beautiful woman on the street, I know I'm not going to talk to her, so it just makes me mad to see her. Walking around looking all pretty, making me feel inadequate. The best way to appreciate a Prius is to never see a Lamborghini. So I treat seeing a beautiful woman on the street like seeing a thug on the street. I'm like, I don't want no trouble, lady. Just keep it moving. Take my money. You was going to take it all anyways. It's like that. Family's on me about getting married. Now, who's single? Who's unmarried here? Unmarried people? Clap it up for yourselves. We need to feel. You unmarried? Are you getting pressure from the family now? Just a little bit? See, problem was, so I turned 30. Everything changed when I turned 30, right? So I'd never been married, had no kids. Now, I was a hero to my family when I was 25. You know, my grandma would brag about me, to, oh, my baby's 25. He don't have no kids. They had a statue of me in front of the church. I had made it. Then I turned 30. What I didn't know was being a 30-year-old man without a wife or kids in my family made me gay. I didn't know that. My mother was the one that broke the news to me on my 30th birthday. She's like, babe, you never want to settle down and have a family? I said, Mom, you know I'm traveling with the comedy. It's hard to maintain a relationship. Oh, do you like techno music? Which is foul because she knows I like techno music. That's just called entrapment. And it's worse now because my grandmother has dementia. So now I have to remind her every 35 to 45 seconds of my failure to procreate. I go home for Christmas, like, baby, you married? I said, no, grandma, I'm working through some things emotionally. I want to make sure I'm not bringing any baggage into the relationship so I can give all that I can give and I don't create any of these patterns that propagate themselves. You know what I'm talking about, grandma. Oh, that makes perfect sense. You wouldn't want your wife to get upset. No, grandma. What I'm saying is I'm not married. I just want to clean up some things real quick before I take that next step. Oh, yeah, you don't want a marriage to get in the way with your wife. You know what, grandma? I'm gay. Well, you know, y'all can get married now, right? You guys ready for the show? Now, this show is called Inside Jokes. It's a little bit different because we get into breaking down the nitty-gritty into how comedy gets made. So what we're going to do is see a bit that Patton Oswalt selected himself from his 2009 special, My Weakness is Strong, which was recorded right here in D.C. Once we finish that clip, I'm going to bring in Patton. We're going to chop it up. We're going to get into how that bit was made, his general approach to comedy. And, of course, you guys have your own questions that you guys wrote down in advance of the show, and we're going to be able to ask those as well. So without further ado, I present to you the magician.
When I started off as a comedian in the late 80s, early 90s, for some reason, I opened up for a lot of comedy magicians. Comedy magicians just ruled the landscape in the early 90s because back then it was like, hey, are you a shitty comedian? Learn a magic trick. Are you a boring magician? Learn a dick joke. You can make $100,000 a year. And they did. These guys were the kings. They just ruled. So I did a one-nighter at a sports bar in Richmond, Kentucky. I did it. And we get there, I'm opening for a comedy magician. I'm getting $25 to open. He's getting $75 to close. I really needed that $25. Needed it very badly. So we get to the sports bar and the bartender meets us and says, "Brad Booker told you wrong, cause the opening guy, you're getting 20 and a magic man, you're just gonna get 70. We've been shorted $5. There's nothing I can do. I need the 20. I'm in. The magician has the ugliest meltdown I've ever seen. He doesn't scream and yell either. He does that thing when you get so fucking angry. You begin speaking very quietly, but you over-enunciate every word that comes out of your mouth. Because what you're telling me is the $75 that I was contractually told I would receive has been reduced to $70. Is that what the fuck you're saying? And the bartender's reaction is, yep, that's what the booker said. Like, he can't see murder when it's an inch from his face. So, the way that a comedy magician worked was, they had a stool on stage, and on the stool, they would put a suitcase, open suitcase, and in the suitcase, they had arranged very neatly all of their magic tricks. And then over here, they had a laundry hamper. So what they would do is, they'd reach into the suitcase, they'd grab a trick. They'd do the trick. They'd do a joke, John Wayne Bobbitt. They would then take the now completed trick and throw it into the hamper. So at the end of the set, stage is not all cluttered. They just grab the hamper, they grab the suitcase, they go off stage, and they reload the suitcase from the hamper, which I've seen happen dozens of times. It's the saddest thing I've ever seen. It's a Tom Waits song come to life, where it's, and the sad old magician is reloading his suitcase, and the one-legged merman. It's fucking horrible. It's horrible. But that's how they did it. I go out, I do my set, silence, boo, thank you. I go off stage, the magician goes out. He is so pissed off at the bartender, still furious. Here's how he does his act. Ready? All right, I got a ball in my hand. Now it's two balls, now it's three, now it's one again. Okay, bam. Now, I got a rope. It's one rope. I snip it in two. It's two. Now it's one again. Okay? Bam! No banter, no jokes. Hate fucked the crowd with magic for 10 minutes. It was fucking amazing. And what kind of sad was he was an amazing magician. He was really good. So there was something really beautiful about that level of skill just used for petty vengeance. Just a guy, like a wonder worker. Oh, look, it's a rabbit out of a hat, you fucking f***. Wham! And by the way, that was his abracadabra. Okay? Okay? Okay. And let's review. What invoked the wrath of the wizard? $5. $5? Really? I thought to piss off a warlock, you had to burn down his village or kill his familiar, something. No, all you have to do, steal $5 from him. 20 quarters, 20 games of Galaga, and he will invoke a... He will invoke a thorny doom from beneath the crust of the earth. Okay! The crowd hated him. They fucking hated him. Dead silent. Dead silent watching him. I'm in the back of the room laughing so fucking hard. So I was howling. It's the funniest thing I've ever seen. So the crowd would watch the magician, then they'd look back at me. Then they'd look back at the magician like they're trying to piece this together. Is this some kind of avant-garde German theater bullshit where a comedian goes up and he just fucking sucks and then a magician goes on and he yells at us and then they dress a lesbian in boys' clothing in the back of the room and you realize halfway through, oh, that's that shitty fucking comedian. And he's back there cackling in the darkness like a half-remembered nightmare through a cracked mirror of regret. Is that what the... Because if that's what the fuck this is, I've seen it done better. That's all I'm saying, man. Thank you so much, Washington, D.C. Good night!
Without further ado, from movies, television, stand-up, and even real life, the Patton Oswalt. How you doing? How awkward is it to know that we were all watching your stand-up as you wait outside?
It did feel like almost like I was a defendant in a court case, that you were watching evidence and then I was about to be brought in here and go, now, sir, please defend that. Yeah, felt a little weird.
Now, well, that was 10 years ago. Was there anything you're like, oh, I wish I... You know what? I would have done that differently. Oh, I would have moved that. I would have changed.
Well, there were definitely some, you know... The ways, as you get older, you get way more efficient in the getting into a bit. So that was the one thing that struck me was, oh, just cut out all of this setup. But, you know, the older you get, the more confident you get as to what is funny and what isn't funny and what you... So and this is one of those bits where, oh, I'm going to need a lot of setup to get the audience ready. You actually don't. I could have gone into it way faster.
One of the most efficient parts was your set was just silence. Boo! Thank you.
That was a nice preview as to where I kind of am as a comedian now. Of I trusted just the bam, 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 and then that's where the laugh was going to be. You know, so that was very, very happy about that. To see that, yes, that was nice. Like, oh, good, some early maturity on my part.
Because I would imagine it was for me, it had been a bunch of sets of me doing my terrible
oh my
set.
God.
Yeah,
and trying again, to make it funny when it wasn't funny the first time.
If I had done that bit 5 years earlier, I bet that's exactly what I would have done. I would have done actual chunks of the set and made the audience walk through it. Whereas, no, you can give them the actual feeling for it,
yeah.
And then that's the bigger laugh.
Now, I do have to congratulate you on the phrase, hate fuck the crowd with magic.
I mean, yeah, that maybe that's a little writerly, but I will say, emotionally remembering that night, that is, you know, like when you remember things, you don't actually remember the specific details, the exact words, but you remember the impression of the event mm-hmm. and how it stayed with you emotionally. Just like people will remember movies in a certain way, you remember the parts that jolt you, sometimes irrespective of the plot. And that was one of those, you know, again, I wrote it decades later, but that is the sense memory I have of the night, is a guy doing magic at people, like an assault. He was doing his act at the audience to punish them. And so, and then of course, then my wonderful poetic brain came up with hate fuck the crowd with magic.
Did it take 5 years for you to realize, you know what, this should be a bit? It was just like a story you're telling other comics at diners, and you're like, you got to do that, man.
Yeah, no, there was, it sometimes it takes you a long time to, there were certain stories that I would tell, not just about my career, but about my life, that, yeah, it took me a while to go, oh, wait a minute, there's a bit there. There was a bit I do in my newest special, I just recorded it, that was a story I would tell variations of it ever since I was a teenager, basically, of working as a wedding DJ. And I never really saw it turning into a bit. And now, just now, 30 years after it happening, I found a way to make it a viable comedy bit. But, you know, it's just things you put down in a notebook, or things that sometimes ideas will tell you when they're worth pursuing. If they keep coming up by themselves, that means it's probably worth pursuing. I remember famously, you know, Stephen King saying he does not keep notebooks or journals, because he said if an idea doesn't stay in my head, that's my head's way of going, don't need to worry about this one. Mm. But if the idea keeps coming up, that's your brain's way of going, hey, check this one out. So that was always his filing system for what he should work on.
Now, what's the balance between you thinking, that's amazing, I have to make that into a bit, and bits just happening and creating themselves organically?
Oh, that's a good question. See, that bit didn't become a bit for me until I was further along in my career and a little more confident in myself, and also had the humility to look back and go, oh yeah, there was a time, a long time, when I was not a great comedian and was very not that cognizant of what was going on around me in terms of art or not art. To me, that was just a funny story of a terrible one-nighter in Richmond, Kentucky. It took me till I, you know, had been in the business long enough to go, oh, wait a minute, there was something way more deeper and human and cosmic going on there that I didn't see at the time. But then there's been other times when a bit has pretty much fallen almost fully formed into my lap. Mm-hmm. I remember there's a bit that I do about seeing a rat in my backyard on the 3rd of July, and I pretty much, the whole, all the events of that thing happening were a bit literally the following Monday at the Largo. Like, mm-hmm. It happened over the weekend, I thought about it and went, my God, that all was so crazy, and I did it that Monday, and it immediately worked. It was one of those, oh, okay, an event just happened.
I find it almost incredible in today's day and age that you've not been able to identify who that comedian is, or at least a fake version. Like, I can't believe there's not a Patton Oswalt's comedian account on Twitter somewhere.
How long have you been doing stand-up?
About 10 years.
10 years. There have to have been horrible one-nighters you've done, or horrible gigs with, and you've probably experienced this too. There were comedians that I remember, some whose names I remember, some whose names I don't, that were just everywhere doing comedy, and then the next thing you knew, they're just not doing it anymore, and you never find out what happens to them. And again, this guy was a very good magician. He was an okay, I don't think comedy was his true calling. Maybe he does cruise ships now and does very well, or does like magic shows or corporate stuff. There's plenty of ways to make tons of money in this business, but it was one of those things where the event of what he was meant so much more than what his name was, or even, I don't even remember his face all that much. It was more the, haven't you ever had that where there it was like, there was an event, but you can't specifically remember the names of the people?
Yeah.
Yeah. And also, coming up in showbiz, you're going to go, I'm haunted by this guy named, there's a child actor named Paul Quant, and he played Chris Makepeace's best friend in My Bodyguard. He was a short, redheaded kid, one of the most natural actors I've ever seen, just so funny in that movie. Only movie he ever did. And I was like, why? He literally has no other IMDb listing, no Wikipedia page, no trivia, no biographical information, nothing. And I was like, what is going on? Why does this guy, one brilliant performance and he's out? And then I found him later online. He's like a speaker and talks to like banks about, you know, building teams or stuff like that. It was almost like he did a movie when he was 8 and went, yeah, I'm done. And I, you know, like that, and that was that. So sometimes there are people that exist for a very short period of time in one specific career, and then they're just gone. And that's, to me, such a fascinating part of life, that this guy was making a viable living doing one-nighters and probably weekend shows, and then probably a couple years later, I'm out. And never regretted it, never looked back.
It's like, how dare you not chase that, filling that eternal hole that the all rest of us have.
Well, and also, exactly. Hey, yeah, how dare you become self-actualized and happy? And you know what I mean? But and also, like, there's also part of me that was like, he really fought a battle that night. Like, he kind of touched something real and emotional on stage. So you would think he would, there'd be a part of him goes, well, you've committed all the way to this now. You know, that'd be like Johnny Cash going on stage at the Grand Ole Opry, and remember he had that freak out and kicked all the lights out and everything, and then he's like, yeah, I'm done with country music. Like, really? You, after that huge thing, you'd said you're done? Like, I would, you would think you would doubly commit to it after that.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that's always been like a mystery in my life.
What's so interesting is that interconnectivity with performers, comedians specifically of different types, where when you see them going through something on stage, whether they're bombing or whether they're working something out emotionally, that's almost more interesting than watching them kill. You're like, okay, no, this is good.
I'm here for an event. It's only going to happen tonight.
Yes.
This is probably not going to happen again, or it's not going to happen again in this form, you know? One of the things I've always been jealous of. Thank you so much. I've always been very jealous. You know, like, what would you do with a time machine? You know, there's all these like cultural things I would go. Like, I wouldn't go see Lincoln get assassinated. I would go like see like the Beatles at the Cavern Club, like for their first gig together with Ringo, or like, you know, these things forming. And I've always been jealous of whoever the audience was at the Palladium. The night that Richard Pryor was taping live on the Sunset Strip, the first show, he had this epic meltdown on stage. And so the one that got released in the films, well, they quickly booked a second night. He regrouped the next day, and then that was the set that you saw. But because it was the night after, you know, it was his first show after setting himself on fire.
Yeah.
And so he went up, and he just wasn't ready to deal with it. And it, but I will bet that in that evening of it going horribly wrong, there were moments of brilliance that most comedians can only dream of. And, you know, he's an artist, and you should be allowed dignity and ego. He's like, I don't want to put that out. But it would be amazing just for comedians to see a genius like that struggling with disaster and like, seeing how he did that. So I would, like, that'd be one of those things. I would go to the first night at the Palladium and see what, was it, no, I think it was, maybe it was the Pantages, but it was something in Hollywood. I think it was the Pantages. Oh, shoot. Now I can't remember the theater. It was either Palladium or Pantages, but he's there. It's for a movie. Everyone's waiting to see him because, oh, my God, he's back. He almost died. And he goes out, and it does not happen. Mm-hmm. That must have been so terrifying, but also so amazing. You know?
It's interesting about him specifically because he has all of these records that he recorded in these tiny clubs that came out before he really blew up, and there's no laugh track added to it.
My
it's
God.
Literally just the gnat sound of it, and it's
only
him rambling.
It wasn't even, here's what's amazing. Those records weren't even the ones he put out before he made it. What happened was he recorded all these records on these smaller labels, and they hadn't, I think they put a couple of them out. Then he became huge. So once he became huge, then they started But they had all these recordings that they had the rights to. Then they started putting them out in between. So when he did live in concert, then they put out, like, Are You Serious? Like, so there were these. So you would see, it was almost like his career comedically happened in a time warp where you would see, you know, 1978 Richard Pryor, and then the next year an album from 1972 came out. Mm-hmm. So you would see this weird backwards and forwards. And even the early stuff when he was like, one of my favorite comedy albums is Are You Serious? Because that's the album where you can hear Richard Pryor really making the transition from being a Bill Cosby wannabe to turning into Richard Pryor. And it's stunning to listen to. You know, it really is a genius forming in front of your eyes. Mm-hmm. And that was because someone captured it really early on, and he didn't have control over these recordings. They're like, we're just going to put these out. It was so good.
Now, are there any comics that you wouldn't have identified as an inspiration when you started, that as you go along, you're like, oh.
Yeah. Oh, wow, that's a really good question. Yeah. This is going to sound really, really weird because my big beacons coming up were first Bill Cosby, then Pryor and Carlin literally at the same time, and then Steve Martin. Steve Martin was like, and I remember Steve Martin was a very specific thing for me because my friends had Monty Python albums, and I remember very clearly my friend Sean Dunlop played me And Now for Something Completely Different. And I listened to two tracks and I went, this is stupid. It's not funny. What is this? And I was like 11. I don't get this. This is dumb. And he went, oh, this is brilliant. I'm like, nah, it's stupid. Turn it off. And then I went home and my dad had just bought Wild and Crazy Guy, the Steve Martin album.
Yeah.
And I listened to it. And in listening to Steve Martin, I understood Monty Python. I got the weird postmodern avant-garde feel to it. Mm-hmm. So those are my ones coming up. How now, as I get older, now I'm going back. I just listened to, and this is going to sound really strange, you know, because obviously then my influences were everyone that I worked with as a comedian. So people like Bill Hicks, David Cross, Maria Bamford, Sarah Silverman, my friends and colleagues. I was just listening to a Henny Youngman album. And Henny Youngman, for me, was almost like an abstract punchline, like, oh, I'm not doing that Henny Youngman stuff. Mm-hmm. Yes, his jokes are very, very corny, but it is, you talk about like, people talk about how the Ramones were like the early 70s bloat of bands like Yes and Emerson, Lake and Palmer, and then they came back and stripped everything down to its essence. Henny Youngman is comedy literally stripped down to just set up, punchline. And not only is it set up, punchline, it's instead of doing 2-minute bits, in 2 minutes, he does 81 jokes. Like the rapidity of it, after a while, it's just the constant barrage that starts making you laugh. Mm-hmm. This guy just will not stop. And everything is so pared down to its essence that it almost becomes abstract. And also, I was watching old Rodney Dangerfield stuff, not just the No Respect album. I mean, like, stuff on YouTube from when he was on Ed Sullivan and stuff. Like, it is such a, again, as you get older, you actually appreciate people that can do more with less. The more stripped down, can you do it more and more stripped down, you know? And I guess I'm getting to that age where I'm fascinated with how can people do it so stripped down and minimally, you know? I think that's why I love people like Anthony Jeselnik so much, because it is, there's not a single unnecessary word in any of those bits that he does. It's incredible.
It kind of reminds me of, have you ever heard Born Suspect, which is Chris Rock's first album?
Yes.
Before he had all of the theatrics. It's just the words, and he's just as brilliant, but it's just the words. And I'm like, that's like an open micer doing Chris Rock's bits.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, he had, it's like he had the Chris Rock mind, but not the Chris Rock persona and fuel to the mind. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I worked with him in Baltimore, I think like back in 1990, and he had, this was before Bring the Pain, and he was doing early versions of a lot of the bits that made him famous from Bring the Pain, and it just like there's a very early Richard Pryor concert film that was done before Live in Concert, and you see a little snippet of it at the beginning of Live in Concert when he's at the Comedy Store. It's the snippet, like there's all these balloons on stage, and he's like fucking with the crowd a little bit, but that set was the audience was not going with him at that point. He was doing the junkie character and stuff. They're just like, I don't like this at all. And Chris was doing some of the stuff that got him accolades in Bring the Pain when I was with him at the Comedy Factory Outlet in Baltimore, Maryland.
Oh, yeah.
and there were some of those bits that made him famous, but that night the crowd was like, no, I'm not here for this. Like, they weren't ready yet. And he hadn't found a way to make what he did just undeniable, you know? But it was, and again, it's interesting to see that.
You gotta love the Comedy Factory Outlet. They're literally being honest about it. We're selling these jokes. This is
what's... Oh my God! They literally they did shows. Oh my God! There was a show they would do called Bucky Yuck, and it was six comedians for $6. So if you want to talk about the commodification of comedy, where literally the club is going, we this is going to be minimal effort on your part, minimal money. Just please come and buy some drinks and we won't bother you with this bullshit comedy. Like, that was literally the feel of the evening. Like, you were the fifth most important thing in the room that night.
Yeah.
Yeah, it really was. It was amazing.
Now, what made you choose that particular bit to break down?
A couple of things. One was the fact that there was a story to it, which is that it happened. It was just a story that I told to friends, and it took me a while to realize, oh, wait a minute. There's actually a bit here. That's the kind of bit, and I'm not bragging, but that's the kind of bit that you can't. It's very hard to do something like that at the beginning of your career, because it takes being comfortable enough on stage to hop into different characters, to be very comfortable with some silences, to be very comfortable with saying things that are interesting and make the audience fascinated with what you're saying, but aren't necessarily funny. And sometimes that is just as important for a comedian as, no, these aren't getting laughs, but what I'm saying is still very interesting, and it's worth your time to listen to it. The whole thing about, you know, loading the suitcase, throwing it into the laundry basket, yeah. Reloading it. There's not really a joke till the end when I make that note. Yeah. But up until then, I'm just explaining how this thing goes, but I'm making it interesting enough, going, oh, yeah, that is how those guys, you know, do that. Mm-hmm. And you know what it reminds me of? Getting back to Pryor, he has a bit on one of his early albums. I remember this was so embarrassing. I had just started doing comedy. I had just started to get some steady laughs, and I was listening to what I would just listen to his stuff all the time. And he has a bit called "God Is a Junkie," and it's a panel talk show where there's like three different people and a host, and they're debating as to what God is. And so there's a host. There's this woman who's like this very clearly kind of damaged born-again Christian. And then there's like just a very straight white minister and then a radical like Black Panther guy. And they're having this argument, and the bit is, he's so brilliant because he doesn't introduce, and now this is a bit about a talk show and here's this guy. He just goes into the voices and you can tell exactly who everyone is, what their relationship is, you know, without him. So, and I went on stage and I tried to do a bit like that about a thing that happened in school, like a debate, and I thought I could do it. I thought I was advanced enough to be able to just hop into these characters, and it looked like I was like having a stroke on stage. Like I was doing these weird, and it was that thing, Ozzy Osbourne said it, all these bands get like one album out, and it goes pretty good, and they go, now it's time for us to do our Revolver. It's like, no, it's not. You actually need to wait about 10 years before you can do Revolver. You're not going to do that yet. Do another album, but you're not. And it was me wanting to jump the line and go, I can do what Pryor's doing. It's like, no, you can't. You're starting to get a couple of laughs. Spend another 10 years getting comfortable on stage, then you can do stuff like that. So this bit was my God is a junkie. Mm-hmm. It was that, am I confident enough to hop back and forth? And even, by the way, I'm still not as confident as Richard because I am talking in first person, and then this happens, and then this happens. I just don't go into, you know, the characters without introducing them. I'm still not there yet, but, you know, that was my way of going, okay, maybe I've advanced a little bit.
Well, one of my favorite things was the whisper anger. What you mean to tell me is that you're going to take... I love that. I don't know if I've ever seen... another comic talk about that on stage, but it's one of the most hysterical things to watch just in life.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, well, I mean, that's a real, you know, especially for comedians, there's going to be moments when, one of the disadvantages of being a comedian is, yes, maybe you're a little more perceptive than other people, but a lot of times that isn't an advantage because when you should be perceptive of other people, you're also hyper-perceptive of yourself. And so a lot of times you will miss things that maybe not so perceptive people will pick up about other people. So you have to, you know, as you go further and further, it's okay to check in every now and then and go, wait a minute, am I just crouching inside my own head right now thinking about my bullshit, or should I take this opportunity if someone's being annoying, or especially if something's being boring? Usually a good sign as you get older, if you're a creative person, if something's being if a situation or person is being boring or annoying, you are actually being presented with material, but you don't know it because you're too busy being bored and trying to escape the boredom. if you can somehow take a step back, there's actually stuff there for you. And one of the best examples of that is there's a early Brian Regan bit about being at the donut shop and buying a dozen donuts, and which is, again, I've done. We all check out. We're doing. Yeah, two glazed, two plain, two chocolate, two coconut. And one's the sprinkles. How many I left? Two. Yeah, and then he does it, but he actually takes time to go how your brain takes you through it, which is the funniest thing. And it was him. Clearly, he was doing something that we all check out doing. He goes, what if I check back in doing this? There might be a bit here, and there is, and it's brilliant.
You know, it's interesting you should say that, because it's like that comedic brain that evaluates the room, that's hyper-perceptive of emotions and feelings and vibes and that kind of stuff, can be such a liability off of a comedy stage.
Or it can be a liability for writing comedy, because as much as you're perceiving, a lot of that gets canceled out by your own narcissistic bullshit. Mm-hmm. So if you can get beyond that and really work on that, you can end up, the world is constantly presenting you with Glengarry leads if you're willing to pick up on them, you know? So, and I mean, someone, again, that just shows you what a genius Richard Pryor was, because think of the turmoil that was in that guy's head all day, and he was still able to literally do bits where he could like personify stuff like wind, literally wind. The cold wind in Chicago became a character in a bit. Like, that's just astounding. Especially like when I'm out, if you've been in Chicago in the winter and you walk out, that wind hits you, everything shuts down. You're like, get me back inside. And I'm sure he went through the same annoyance, but he's like, oh no, there's a bit here. Mm-hmm. In the middle of all this pain and shittiness, I've actually figured something out about literally the universe. Like, it blows me away watching that.
What I've actually found so fascinating watching your special, I believe it was Annihilation.
Yeah.
You had the story about the clown.
Yes.
And the woman who's having the children's birthday party says...
Oh, that was the one, yeah, before Annihilation.
Oh, was that? Okay.
Yeah, no, it's okay. Yeah. But I know what you're talking about. It's it's that horrible party clown that I...
Yes.
Said it. Yeah.
But where she goes, I'm so pissed, but I want to see where this goes.
Yes. Oh, my God.
You know how many times I say that just in life?
Yeah.
And I feel like all comedians do.
Yeah. But a lot of times, yes. Maybe that was my subconscious way of telling myself, because a lot of times... My line of thinking goes, I am so pissed, and then it just stops there. Mm-hmm. And then I don't see where it goes, because I try to shut it out. But if I would let myself get pissed and then see where it goes, there could be something amazing there.
It's kept me in a lot of bad relationships.
Yeah. Oh, my God. You're right. There's also a disadvantage to that.
Yes.
Sometimes if you're too empathetic, you're going to end up staying in places you shouldn't stay.
Yes.
Holy crap.
Now, how did this end up becoming your closer and your special?
You know what's really weird? You will kind of know as you start working on whatever your new hour is, whatever your new special is, the closer will present itself to you. It's just the bit that it just feels like there's no point in following it up, either because the performance that you have to go through to do it is too involved, or the laugh that it lands on, as you get older, you know, oh, that's the one that's the closer. Although I will say, in this latest special that I just taped, there was a bit that up until a month before I taped the special, I thought went in the middle of the set. And then this friend of mine, Orlando Leyba, we were on the road a month before, and he was like, you know that bit you do in the middle? That's your closer. Have you thought about that? And it was... like, if you could have done the Hitchcock zoom on me, you know, with a whoa, that's right in it. Like, it was so be open to, you know, I've been doing this for 30 years and I still need someone to point stuff out to me. Mm-hmm. That's totally fine.
Well, it's the outside versus the inside.
Like, yes. Well, exactly. Yeah. It helps to have, that's another great advantage though of being a comedian. You're usually hanging out with other comedians. Mm-hmm. And especially if you hang out with comedians that are very, you know, you make them comfortable enough to have them go, dude, that doesn't work. It's like, if you, there's nothing makes comedians better than A, not being the funniest guy in the circle you hang out in, and B, having friends that are willing to bust your balls. Mm-hmm. And you can tell, not just comedians, actors, directors, writers, who lose that group of people around them. It's like, dude, no. What the hell are you doing? You know, that's why most people, all their best work is when they're young, because that's when they still had people around them that were going, I don't know, man. And they either had to really prove their point or go, oh, shit, yeah, I should probably cut that.
Speaking of which, there's a new Rocky out right now.
Rambo.
No, Rambo. Don't there you hate that you got Rambo. A good joke and you say the wrong word? You're like,
I did that this morning. A friend of mine tweeted something, and I dunked on her, and then people were like, actually, no, that someone else wrote that song. I'm like, God damn it, and I had to delete it. And you know, speaking of that, like having people around you to bust your balls, the movie Young Frankenstein, there's a now classic scene when Gene Wilder and Peter Boyle sing Puttin' on the Ritz. Remember that scene, which is one of it's the highlight of the film. And Gene Wilder and, you know, Mel Brooks wrote the movie together, and Gene Wilder came up with that scene, and Mel's like, that's stupid. That doesn't work for me. Mm-hmm. This is like months before, and then she's like, no, that will be. And Mel's like, I just don't see it. I mean, explain it to me again. I don't see it. And like literally up until the week before they were going to shoot it, Mel's like, I don't think we need it in the script. It's just not going to work. Mm-hmm. It will be cut. It's too stupid. And then they finally find, and Gene just fought and fought and fought. And then they shot it. And it's on the poster. They're in their tuxes with the top hats on the poster. That's how good that scene is. And then Gene was like, why did you give me so much hell? Mm-hmm. And then Mel was like, because I didn't see it. And you can miss good things. And the fact that you would not give up for months told me that this must be good. Like that. That's the kind of humility and genius Mel Brooks had. He was able to go, oh, I know when I don't see something, and I'm going to see how long this guy fights for it.
Gene Wilder, that was one of the biggest disconnects when he passed between me and everybody else. I'm like, this guy's brilliant. You're like, what, the actor guy?
Yeah,
what?
Yeah, exactly. They didn't know him.
Mean Charlie?
Oh, I know. Like the stuff that... You know, especially talk about a track record. You know, mm-hmm. like his film debut is Bonnie and Clyde. Then he, you know, then it's The Producers. Then it's, you know, Young Frank, Blazing Saddles, Young Frank, just boom.
Blazing Saddles.
Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory, just boom, boom, boom. You know,
yeah.
And the most unhinged meltdown ever on screen went in Young Frankenstein when the monster doesn't live and he just. Like, he totally goes for it. I don't think they did more than one take of that. I think Mel's like, yeah, we're good. Why don't you go lie down? Let's get him a potassium drip and let him... Like, he just... Watch that scene again and then he goes, we need to take our failures with grace and... No, it was with dignity and quiet grace. And then he has the ugliest meltdown you've ever seen. It's so brilliant.
Now, in watching that bit, I know it's been a while since we've seen it, but in watching that bit, we didn't bleep anything except for the one word.
Yes.
Yes. And that was recorded in 2009.
Mm-hmm.
So my question is, if you
you're
did
gonna
that
cancel
bit
me,
today...
You're going to cancel me? No. If I did that bit today, obviously, yeah, I would change that word. You know, we are living in, unfortunately, you know, and the reason that I used the word was not because, oh, I want to... I was like, I'm making fun of how shitty and ignorant this guy is. You know, mm-hmm. that's how you used to make fun of people that were racist or homophobic. You had to show how awful and ugly that their language sounded. Unfortunately, that kind of irony we are living, you know, I've always said that like the whoever is the president sets the mood for the country. So if you, and especially in terms of art and culture. So if you look at like the art and culture that was made when Nixon was president, everything was about paranoia and conspiracy and wheels within wheels, and you can't trust anybody. And then, you know, when Reagan came in, it was all gung-ho America, Rambo, Rocky beating up a Russian, you know, Red Dawn. It really was. And then when Clinton came in, it was like this, oh, it's the post-baby boomer irony, irony, irony. It's all like retro, but kind of fun. Then when George Bush became president, it was all about torture. And it was literally, it was films like Saw and Hostel. It was all torture, 24, torture, torture, torture. Obama becomes president, it's all superheroes. Literally, it was, these superhero people are coming out of the sky. Now, we have a president who has no abstract thought, no irony, no object permanence, basically. And so there's no more irony. Like you, so I can't, if I'm on that stage, even if I'm putting that word in the mouth of the most ignorant, shitty person, everyone's like, you said it, you're gone. Like, there's no more disconnect. So we've lost, we are now, unfortunately, we're post-nuance because of the president. So I would very much, and also because that clip would be used to hurt me. It would be used to hurt people that are LGBT. It would be hurt, like, everything can now be taken out of context and recut and used and weaponized. So I don't want to give the MAGA chuds out there who are now have taken what, you know, like people like Sarah Silverman and Key and Peele and Dave Chappelle were able to make fun of racism and homophobia by doing it ironically. That has now been grabbed by actual racists and homophobics and going, well, they did it. I could, like, so it's like, okay, well, now we're post that now. We have to, like, wait this shit out. So, yeah.
You know, it's fascinating because Dave Chappelle had his special just drop on Netflix, and I'm a huge Dave Chappelle fan. He's like
my North
Star.
He and I started comedy on the same night.
Did you really? Who did better?
At Garvin's, he was 14. I was 19.
Okay.
I don't know what happened to his career, but I mean, I'm doing okay. I don't know if he. I saw him do comedy that night. He was good.
No, I mean that night. Who did better that night?
He did. He was 14, and I remember I was in the back of the room, and I didn't know anyone, but I saw two older comedians, Mark Voice and Bob Thurmy, and the host, the Fat Doctor. Darcel Blackman.
Yeah.
And they were saying, this kid looks like he's been doing this for 40 years. Like, he literally was on, say, he went up, he was 14, his mom drove him there. And he walked on stage like he was a visiting celebrity that was already established and just killed. It was stunning, like 14 years old. And you're like, well, that, and I remember as much of a like pasty suburban punk that I was, I was able to go, that guy's going to be huge. Like, I'm in a room where somebody massive just walked on, and I got to see the beginning of it.
I think one of the most exhilarating / frustrating things in watching a comedian is a perfectly articulated bit about something you thought but never actually processed bit.
Yes.
But you did that with something I'm not at the point where I'm confident enough to do, where you did the two characters. And you were talking about words versus meaning. And that's in a lot of ways where we are right now, is that you grab onto the words and not necessarily the larger picture.
Right, but you know what's really sad? It makes me very depressed when I watch that bit. I do a bit about how, you know, because I was very much against a lot of the word policing and, you know, stuff that was going on. Because, again, this was still just before Trump, where I was like, the thing about evil, racist, homophobic, misogynistic people is they are the first ones to learn whatever the correct term is in the moment so they can smuggle their evil shit in. And it's a lot of times people that have the best intentions, because their actions are good, they're like, well, I don't need to know the terminology. And then they end up sometimes getting more shit than the people that are, because people aren't really listening for women. What's the, so I do a whole bit about this one guy going, while I certainly appreciate people's alternative lifestyles and points of view, obviously the male-female relationship is a biological imperative, certainly. And he's clearly, it's a guy very politely and eruditely, I'm sure I said that word wrong, arguing against gay marriage, against something like that. And then there's another guy going, if a couple of fags want to adopt a kid, what the fuck is that of yours, asshole? Like, these guys, you fuck. So you're just like, wait, what the, you know. But people, like, look at the words for, you know. But again, I'm actually wistful for that bit now because I was actually, based on how things are now, I was wrong. Because people will, because of the way things are being recut and recontextualized, that doesn't actually apply anymore. Mm. Like, that's how far down this, I don't know what it is, that the upside down or the through the mirror, but it just, it's really, really scary now. When you see people, when you see the gleeful bad faith takes by people that are turning cartwheels for the fact that, oh my God, I have a way to just wallow in my racism like this demented hippopotamus. Like, I'm so happy right now. Like, mm-hmm. it's really, really sad.
Now, you know? So there's been this, there's been the idea that comedy is impossible in today's day and age. I've heard that a million times.
No, it's fucking not.
I wanted you to hit that.
No, it's, God damn it. Comedy has always been impossible. People that are going, comedy is impossible now. If you went on stage and said just the word fuck, you used to be arrested. So, and people got through that. So people that are going, comedy is impossible now. No, you just have to evolve and find cleverer ways to say what it is. You want to say, don't you want to be the cleverer one who works out better ways to say things rather than going, why can't I just say the shit people said back in the 70s? Because it's 2019. Don't you want to do something new, asshole? Like, why do people just want, fucking Carlin did this? Yes, he did. And if he was alive today, he would be doing something different. And what's weird is all these people that are so against cancel culture, or, oh my God, there's all this censorship and all these new SJWs and all these, everyone, they are, and then they'll ironically invoke Lenny Bruce, except that during Lenny Bruce's time, everybody railed against Lenny Bruce the same way these people are railing against all these new voices that are coming up. So they don't realize that they are actually the voices of the old vaudevillians that are like, what, he just goes on stage and says pee pee and caca and that's not funny, you know. Why can't you just go on stage and squirt a seltzer bottle and then your pants fall down and everyone's happy? So comedy will always evolve. It will never, ever stay the same as much as you might want it to. It won't. I mean, and it sucks. There's been times when, look, I've had to fight certain things. I've been, you know, called out for shit that I've said, and usually I'll look at it, I'll try to consider it, and sometimes I'll go, I'm sorry, you totally missed the context of that joke, and other times I'm like, shit, I could have done better, you know? And usually when you go, God damn, you got me, I could have done better, then the other people just go, okay, fine. You know, it's not, it's being personified as it's this Mad Max Fury Road PC scalp hunting derby going on out there, when really it's like people going, the fuck are you doing? Like, oh yeah, shit, you're right. I didn't think about that.
Now, you ended your special Annihilation with your which, by the way, I was blown away by that. It was very impressive the way that you were able to, again, evolutions of comedians, and feel confident enough to get away from the setup and the punchline and just be honest and real. And if you guys haven't seen that, I certainly recommend you do it as soon as you leave here. You ended with your late wife's mantra, it's chaos, be kind.
It's chaos, be kind, which I try my best, and I fail a lot at doing that, but I try.
How do you balance that with making jokes and searching for material?
Because especially now that I'm getting older, and this happens as you get older, a lot of your jokes as you get older become more at the expense of yourself rather than, you can always tell a younger comedian because they're always like, here's this stupid thing that I noticed and here's how I said something brilliant and got one better over on this other person. And as you get older, you're like, listen to this stupid shit I did the other day. Oh my God, you're not gonna, you know. So it's more about like showing the vulnerability and trying to go, nothing's actually fatal if you're willing to grow after the disaster. You know, I think that's a better way to be kind.
How do you think it's made you a better comedian? Just
you're open to more experiences. You're open to more viewpoints. Forget being a comedian. If you want to do anything creative, why would you not want to expand your canvas as absolutely wide as you can possibly make it go? Why would you want to figure out one thing you do and then you just repeat variations on that same thing? Like, if you know, it just that's always death. You know, it's fun in the short run, but this is a marathon, and I'd like it to be a function of my life. I don't want my life to be a function of this narrow thing that I'm good at, and then never bother to explore.
I love that. When you talk about doing comedy right now, it kind of reminds me of something Lisa Lampanelli told me years ago, mm-hmm. and she's since gone off and she's doing her own thing, which is fascinating too. But she says, the more outrageous something is, the harder it is to be entertaining about, the harder it is to be funny about. And she was talking about that in the context of presidents, and saying the presidents that were the least interesting and the least entertaining were the ones that were the best fodder for material.
That I agree with. I do it in my new special. I do a bit about all the people that told me, you know, if Trump gets elected, you comedians, it's just going to be Christmas every day for you guys. And he's the worst president for comedy. And I say in my special, I go, the Trump presidency. I go, this is what it's like to be a comedian during the Trump presidency. The Trump presidency is an 18-wheeler full of monkeys and PCP. And it has crashed into a train full of diarrhea. And now there's diarrhea-covered monkeys on PCP running around. And everyone's watching it like, holy shit. And then you as a comedian walk up and go, hey, do you want to hear a joke I wrote about this? And they're like, no, we're good, man. I'm just going to watch. I don't know. You can take a break. Like, you're not needed right now. Like, everyone's, you know, so. He is the worst thing for comedy.
It's funny. You had that other bit about that, about the guy taking the dump on the street and he makes it into a hat.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Don't run from the truth. No, I'm just kidding. Go ahead, please. I'm sorry. It was right there. I couldn't let it go. Sorry. There's no shelf life with Trump jokes. It immediately, he was like making fun of Trump. It's like, there's a crazy guy taking a dump on the sidewalk and he's yelling about Hitler. You turn to your friends and you have this amazing joke about a guy, about him. And as you turn, he then turns his dump into like a sombrero. So when you're telling, like, hey, turn around, he already made it into a sombrero. Like, ah, damn it. Like, there's just no way to keep up.
Yep.
And I go, he's sour cream in a sauna. He just does not keep. Yeah, I know. That's poetry, people.
At this point, I want to have Marissa from D.C. Is she here? Marissa, come on down to that microphone, as well as Matt from Arlington, Allie from Arlington. I think this is Mark from Buffalo.
New York? Wow. Thanks for making the trip, dude.
And Morgan from Eastville.
Ooh. Here we go.
There we go. Starting with Marissa.
All right.
How you doing?
Doing good. So my question is, what of your works are you most proud of and why?
For works that I've been hired to do, like where I had to interpret someone else's work, probably the movie Big Fan, just because it was so bare bones and it was so well written. And the fact that I got handed that script and I didn't screw it up really, really meant a lot to me. And then of the works I've done, of my albums, for some reason, there's something on my second album, Werewolves and Lollipops, where it was, even though we recorded over six nights in Austin, we ended up using just one show, pretty much uncut, because one show, it just was an event that happened. It just all came together so perfectly, and there were even a couple of mistakes, but it's the one recording of mine that actually feels like this is actually happening all spontaneously, warts and all, and I'm really, really happy with it.
I'm not proud of anything I've done. I meant to ask you ever think about doing a Big Fan sequel about this year's Giants?
I want that movie to stay where it is. I don't want to ruin it with a sequel, but thanks.
Matt.
Thank you. This is actually for both of you. You can answer this. What did you watch or listen to in the last year that surprised or inspired you?
You go first, man. Say Annihilation.
Well,
say Annihilation. Annihilation on fucking Netflix.
In preparation for... I did love the preparation for this. Was fascinating.
Really?
Well, you saw how many bits I referenced.
Damn,
and
thanks,
brought up.
Man.
A lot of that stuff was really, really cool to see. I will say, for some reason, Sebastian Maniscalco is a guy who I will just walk with that guy anywhere. And he's literally the furthest away from me. He's like super Italian, and he's got the hat, and he's out in L.A., and he's married. He does the whole thing. He does act outs. I never do act outs. And I'm literally like, I'm with you, man. Whatever he's talking, I don't have you. I'm with you. I literally love watching that guy. And so I would say the fact that I'm still this many specials and that into him, I would say.
The thing that inspired that inspired me and surprised me the most, because I slept on it for so long, was an Amazon show called Fleabag. Yes. I don't know if anyone's seen. Yeah. Yes. Holy shit. We are living, right now, television is what Hollywood was in the early 70s, where it's nothing but brilliant minds, directors, writers, actors doing insane stuff. But Fleabag is something else entirely in terms of, remember what an impact the first, the British series, The Office was in terms of comedy is different now? That to me is how, like when I saw Fleabag, I was like, oh, the way that I think about writing comedy is different now because of that show. It's only two seasons. There's only six episodes a season. They're only a half an hour apiece. You can finish it in a day, and you will be so bummed out when you're. How bummed out were you when you finished it? And then when I finished the second season, I assume like, well, she's working on season three. And then I started reading about her. She's like, nope, that's it. Just those two seasons. I was like, are you fucking? I was so pissed at her. I'm not. This is one of the few things I can actually overhype, and I'm confident that when you do watch it, you're like, oh my God, it's the level of comedy and writing, but then without, and don't read about it, there are some genuinely real twists that take it into territory that would destroy other shows, and it only makes the show better. I can't describe how good it was. So to see that that level of comedy can exist really kind of knocked me for a loop. It's truly is amazing. Who here has seen Fleabag? Hands up. Oh, I'm so jealous. Hang on. Who here hasn't seen Fleabag? God! I'm telling you, if I remember that movie, Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind,
yeah,
where you can erase memories. I would do that method so that I could re-experience Fleabag. I would.
Really?
I would just Netflix? Have him. Oh, I would have him carve out the memory of watching Fleabag and of watching all five seasons of The Wire, so I could watch those the first time. But have you seen Fleabag?
Yes, I have.
Dude,
I did exactly what you did. As soon as the second season was over, I Googled, was like, "Oh, third season," and I was like, "Oh."
Yeah,
no.
She's like, "Yeah, it's all done. That's all I wanted to do." I'm like, "Are you kidding me?" And she writes, directs, acts in Fleabag, and then created and writes Killing Eve.
Yes.
Like, it's just her brain is, it's like next level. So, thank you.
Thank you.
Right. Yeah. Have you seen Fleabag?
I have not.
Dude.
I have not.
I'm so angry at you right now. You're going to get to go watch Fleabag.
Wait, is it Netflix?
Amazon.
It's on Amazon Prime.
Yeah.
Oh, I got like 500 things on Netflix to watch first.
Stop it and watch Fleabag right now.
All right. Fair
I'm telling
enough.
You. All right. Yes.
Hi there. So, Patton, how do you think having a college degree did or did not impact your career as a comedian? And it's okay if you don't like our alma mater.
oh my God, hi.
Hi.
Wow. you know, I had a kind of a bittersweet thing in college where I started comedy between freshman and sophomore year of college. Mm-hmm. And it really clicked with me hard. That's all I wanted. Once I started, it's all I wanted to do. And every weekend at college, I was away doing comedy. It's how I paid my way through college the last 2 years.
Wow.
I was doing enough of it. And
where were you?
I was going to college in Williamsburg. So I was still in Virginia, but I was like going, you know, all around. So, and then I took too many classes in my major, so they didn't count toward my degree. And I was 9 credits short, and I was talking to the guy, and he was like, oh, I just do a whole other year here. Like, don't worry about it. I'm like, well, I have work lined up. Like, he's like, what's your work? I'm like, I'm a comedian. He was like, well, I don't think this college cares about producing comedians. And then I petitioned the committee on degrees, and I was able to graduate. But if comedy, I mean, I'm sure that any, look, going to college or not going to college, if you are living your life fully and committing to those experiences, those will, I know plenty of brilliant comedians, some who never went to college that are, you know, and there's a lot of people who are like, well, I graduated Harvard, so I'm sure I will also kill at this endeavor, and they eat it so hard, and then they watch somebody that barely graduated high school just mop the floor with them, because comedy, it's, you're not working in a bank, it's you're either funny or not, so it just depends on what you truly want to do with, you know, it can't hurt you or help you is all I'm saying.
That actually added a whole nother level of pressure for me, that anybody can just get up and do stand-up. Because well, no, I go into a show and my parents were like, we sent you to school for what exactly?
Yeah, no, exactly. But that's kind of the, I've seen a lot of people that are like, I remember there was a huge panic because a lot of comedy shows, especially SNL and, you know, their recruiting ground was the Harvard Lampoon. Like Harvard was, and then in the late 90s, early aughts, that switched to The Onion was the factory. And The Onion was, there are people that work there that barely got out of high school, but they're brilliant writers and that's what they want. And like the whole, there was a year that all the new Daily Show staffers were ex-Onion people and nobody was from Harvard. And it was like, wait a minute, we had to market on this. Like, not anymore, dude. Stuff changed, and things keep changing. So, you know, it just depends on how funny, it just depends on how funny you are, man.
And social media has helped that, too. A lot of people on Twitter have gotten their writing out that way.
Built their careers on it. Yeah. Megan Amram's whole career was because of Twitter.
Yep.
Yeah.
Hi.
Hi.
As comedians, performers, actors, how do you balance the career needs of seeking the next, hopefully bigger opportunity while retaining the love and focus on what you do so you can remain grateful for what you have?
You know, I'm never looking for the bigger opportunity in terms of, well, there has to be a scale that goes up. I'm looking for what's going to be the most fun and creative opportunity. So sometimes, yeah, you know, there's a TV series or a big movie, but sometimes it can be a really interesting podcast or a weird animated, like something. I've been very lucky that I've gone where the really cool, weird stuff was, and that's actually benefited me more. So like when I went to LA, and it's, you got to get on at the Comedy Store, and then I found this little room before it was the Largo called the Onyx, this little room one night a week on Vermont Avenue that then moved across street, that then moved to the Largo, that then became, so I went where I was the most comfortable and the most challenged and had the most fun, rather than, well, here's the thing you got to get on right now. And, you know, there's so many people that, and I think it's a disservice to comedians or to anyone creative where they're like, you've got one shot, you've got one chance. No, you don't. You have a long career full of ups and downs and reversals and weird sidetracks. There's no, like, you got to get on the Tonight Show and then you get your sitcom, and if that doesn't happen, you're done. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
It's one of the, I mean, irregardless of how I feel about him, one of the things that's really sad about Shane Gillis is he's getting stomped into his head that you had SNL, then you lost it, you're done. Maybe, maybe not, but why make comedians think that way, that you have one shot and if you blow it, forget it? That's a terrible way to pursue anything creative. You know, think of all the massive opportunities that Richard Pryor burned to the ground, and he still ended up being Richard Pryor. He literally, they wanted him to star in Blazing Saddles. He was going to be the star, and then he went AWOL a week beforehand because he went on a drug toot, and then the studio was like, we can't insure him, and was like, well, he's done. Mm-hmm. He's done. Like, there's no such thing as you've got one shot. I hate that way of thinking.
Well, Kanye's been canceled 50,000 times,
yeah.
And he was
exactly, just
the number one grossing rapper,
yeah,
beat
exactly.
Jay-Z.
Because then he goes and he writes something brilliant. So, to get back to your question, yeah. Also, to balance all these things out, writing and acting and stand-up, is it just comes down to, like, being mature and scheduling things and being able to look soberly at your camera and go, I have to let this thing go if I want to do, because I want to do a lot of things, but I want to do them all well. And if I say yes to everything, yes, I'll do everything, and I'll do it all mediocre. And I don't want to do that. So some stuff you got to let go, you know? You know, so I got a call from this guy, something Spielberg. I'm like, dude, I'm talking at the Kennedy Center. I can't go to your studio, you know? He's like, I'm shooting a movie. I'm like, New watches movies, right? You know,
yeah.
So I was like, sorry, you know? I make really good decisions, guys. That's what I'm saying.
You already delved into this a little bit a couple questions ago. But I have a roommate, and the two of us are William & Mary grads.
When did you graduate?
2014.
Oh, my God. You're puppies. I graduated in 91.
And I was just curious if there was a moment that stood out to you, one of those ideas that keeps cropping up from your time with the tribe, one of those moments that maybe one day will become a comedy feature.
Well, I mean, I do a bit about, I took a physics for poets class when I was in that whole bit, and that is very much about William & Mary, you know. So yeah, there was, obviously there was, but again, weirdly enough, because of my comedy career, I don't have that many college memories because I was always, after sophomore year, I really started to do the road regularly. So come Friday, my last class would end at 2, and I was usually getting in my car to go to a gig and go off somewhere, you know, because back then, it was near the tail end of the boom, but there were still clubs. There were 3 clubs in Richmond. There were 2 clubs in Raleigh. There was, you know, you could go out. There were 2 clubs in Newport News. Like, you could go and do clubs and make money, and that's what I was doing.
You know how jealous, when you were talking about, I have road work. I'm like, I was in New York City, so I was at Columbia.
Oh.
I was actually there with Jenny Slate and Chelsea Peretti were there.
Oh, my God,
time.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
But it was 5 minutes. If you're lucky, mm-hmm. you wait around and you do 5 minutes. And I'm talking to people.
What years were these, though?
When were you there? I was there. I've graduated in 02.
Okay.
Chelsea graduated 2000. Mm-hmm. I think Jenny Slate graduated 2003.
Well, the thing is, though, yeah, it's 5 minutes. But it's 5 minutes. If you work it right, you can do 3 rooms a night. Mm-hmm. And if you really are hustling, you can go open a room somewhere, find a space and go, let me do, you know, because once the boom ended, then it was all comedians going to some books were like, can we put a mic in here and do a show once a week? And mm-hmm. then that became their currency. Everyone that had a room would trade spots with each other, and that's how they all got their stage time. Yes, it was 5 minutes, but it's a barrage, and you learn to get really funny really quick. No, you're not doing half-hour sets, but you have a lot of stages to go on. Mm-hmm. So it balanced out.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I didn't make any money.
No, there's no money.
I certainly.
By the way, I didn't make any money either. I was doing these road gigs. I would get paid, like I would drive to Staunton, Virginia, and have to drive back, and that was $25. That paid for the gas to do it.
Mm.
That's all it was. But I wanted the stage time.
Yeah, yeah.
Jesus, Staunton, you want to hear a bad story? I did a hotel in Staunton, me and a comedian named Lord Corrett, and so we. We go on stage. It's in this ballroom. Imagine a gigantic ballroom that seats 800, and there's 150 people there in one little corner near the front. We both go up. We both eat it, just turf out so hard. Then we leave. We go sit. We are doing 2 shows, 7 o'clock show and 9 o'clock show. Go sit in the bar, have some drinks. It's like, oh, my God, let's just get ready for the 9 o'clock show. And the guys, you know, it's 8:55. Let's go. We go back in the room. It's the same audience. They just were still sitting there at their tables. Like they just like paid for some kind of package for the whole night.
Yeah.
And the owner clearly thought it's like, well, it's like ambient music. You just plug it in. We're like, I did 25 minutes to open the show, and I had exactly 25 minutes of material. That's all I had.
Yeah.
And I just kind of went up and was like, sorry, guys. And it became this weird, like, therapy session where we just kind of went up and were like, I don't know why they did this. Sometimes with these clubs, it was one of the saddest nights I've ever done comedy. And that was $25.
I applaud you for not just shamefully going through the set again.
Yeah. Is anybody here dating? Isn't dating weird? Like, oh, man.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Brutal.
I want to thank you not only just for being here tonight, but for being such a powerful force for good in comedy.
Thank you.
Advocating for comedians, defending the shield, but also being like a shining example of what a lot of us want to be on stage, which is
chubby and white.
Yeah, well.
Yes.
I'd make more money, but, you know. Just being naked. You know, just being honest and being yourself, because I think that is as much as any journey that I'm on as a as an artist, long I do stand up, I just continue to take off more clothes and you know, oh, and just feel more naked on stage. And when I watch you, that's one of the things I see is a guy just really comfortable being naked. That sounds super weird.
And if it's we the Kennedy Center. Way, they get metaphors. So, yeah. They get it. So, yeah.
Patton Oswalt, everybody.
Thank you. Thanks, guys. Thank you.